Live. It's America's longest running talk show on computers. It's Computer America, bringing you the biggest names in technology with guest interviews, new products, and your emails. Listen live at computeramerica.com on any device around the world. Email the show at live@computeramerica.com or find us on social media. Be sure to check out our website for contests, giveaways, show notes, live video stream, podcasts, and more. You're listening to Computer America.
Hello and welcome into the Computer America Show. We are the nation's longest running, nationally syndicated radio talk show on computers and technology. Thank you for joining us, everyone. I'm your host, Ben, and today on the program, second part of the show, we will have computer and technology news, including the the politicians in the UK have no sense of fun because it looks like they're trying to make it illegal to resell automated robots, I'm assuming used by military and other niche fields, to private citizens. And it's just a devastating news to hear today. But we have a lot of news, including that and more. Don't worry. It's going to be a lot of fun. But in the first part of the program, which we'll get to in just a moment, we have GE appliances. Yes, of course, you know them. Many of you have them in your home already, and we're going to be talking about the latest and greatest. I mean, just last week we covered some of the best kitchen gadgets during the holiday season that you can have. And, you know, of course, we tried to stick to kind of like under $100. We're going to be talking about things that are, you know, kind of full-blown ovens and what technology can do to augment and actually improve a kitchen. Seems right up our alley, and we're really excited to have them on. But before we get to that, computeramerica.com, that's where you'll find everything, including today's show notes. So any links to any products that we talk about, anything that we discuss, will be right there. You just sit back and relax. ComputerAmerica.com. That's all you have to remember. Let's see. There's also, of course, our social media links. Check that out. And, of course, the podcasts, all that good stuff. Articles, reviews, blah, blah, blah. So, long story short, there you go. Check out our website. And why don't we go ahead and get started with our program today. And as I said before, GE Appliances, and we have the one, the only, Mr. Jeremy Miller. He is the Smart Home Solutions Commercial Director, just the gentleman we would like to talk to. And wanted to go ahead and bring him on. Jeremy, how you doing? Welcome onto Computer America.
Hey, Ben, how's it going? Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. And I think this is going to be a lot of fun because, long-term listeners of the show know that I'm actually really into cooking. It's a lot of fun, and, you know, kind of kitchen appliances. It's not something I think people ordinarily will kind of geek out about, but, the folks over at GE have a lot going on. So before we get even into that, give us a bit of background on GE and, you know, kind of the GE appliances and, kind of their smart division. When, you know, kind of why did they start getting into the smart space? And then a bit of your background as well. How long have you been working with GE?
Sure. So a little bit about me first. You know, as the commercial director for Smart Home Solutions at GE Appliances, I oversee our marketing strategy for, you know, what we do around our smart solutions and our smart products. And I've been with the company now for about 2.5 years. Prior to that, I was actually the VP of marketing at Sentient Technologies, which was an artificial intelligence firm. And we were primarily focusing on how to leverage a certain type of AI called computer evolution, which some of your listeners are probably familiar with, to apply it to things like finance, digital marketing, and e-commerce. And before that, I worked at a variety of other startups and even did a previous stint with GE. Relative to the company, though, you know, I love to geek out about appliances. I find them incredibly interesting. What's really unique about something like GE appliances is that, you know, we're in millions of consumers' homes. And I think a lot of us in our careers dream about the idea that you could work on something that influences and improves people's lives every day. And so that's why I get so excited to work on these products, because they really are just something that almost every American is interfacing with constantly. And somebody like yourself, like you said, you love to cook, right? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, these products not only serve a purpose to make your life better, but I'm sure that you have an emotional connection to cooking, as well as maybe even a particular cooking product from your childhood or even today, right? A lot of people have strong affinities for the appliances that they have in their homes. And with over 100 years of innovation in this space, you know, GE Appliances has done so much to transform this industry and really deliver better products, you know, products that actually can do more to make our lives easier and more simple, as well as actually delivering new and exciting brands. Right there, you have Cafe and Monogram. You know, Monogram is one of our higher end brands. You know, it's just an incredible product. Cafe is a newer brand that we've launched that really appeals to people's aesthetic senses. And you're talking about kitchen gadgets, by the way. You know, we have launched a new lineup of small appliances, some of which can get connected. That coffee maker is actually a smart coffee maker. So we have all sorts of great products and great brands for our consumers.
And we're going to get into what makes these appliances smart appliances, because, you know, just in my personal life, when I'm telling people that I, you know, you can get like in, let's just say an Amazon connected toilet or something like that, they're like that freaks them out, you know, stuff like that. But really, you know, it's not really that scary when you just consider it's more of like there's a speaker that you can connect to Bluetooth and you can play music in your bathroom, you know, but it's through your toilet, you know. So we're going to talk about, you know, as it pertains to kitchen appliances, what makes a kitchen appliance a smart appliance. But I wanted to, you know, kind of your role as a director for this division, I thought a good place to start would be when you look at, you know, whenever you stand in a kitchen or you stand, you know, surrounded by your lineup and you go, what is kind of the design philosophy that you begin with? Say, this could be improved with this, or do you just kind of go, we can do this, so let's try it out and see how well it works? I mean, is there any kind of method to what gets implemented in what devices?
You know, from a physical product standpoint, you know, we do have an organization within GE Appliances, which is our industrial design organization, that does a lot of prototyping and concept development. And they do it through a variety of modalities, everything from physical prototyping to digital prototyping and testing those things. Mm-hmm. And some of that, you know, manifests itself in terms of just the actual appliance functionality that we are most familiar with, right? Turning the appliance on and off, regulating temperatures, those types of actions. But they also help and assist with kind of ideating around some of the more experiential type of things that you might see in a smart appliance. And so when we start to look at, you know, appliances themselves, and we start to think about how do we make them smart or what could we do, you know, I think the lens hasn't changed in terms of, you know, appliance evolution overall. It's all about convenience, right? Right. You know, it's all about aspirations and it's all about goals. And so we kind of look at it from that context, which is, you know, if we go into a home and we do research with our owners and we do in-home research, you know, we try to understand what is it that you're trying to achieve. And by looking at that and seeing where there's opportunity, we might think to ourselves, well, how might we apply smart technology to help these people achieve their goals? Now, let's take you for an example, somebody who likes to cook, and all of us like to, you know, cook for the most part, but all of us are kind of at different levels, you know, per se. And so when we look at how we can help the aspirational cook or how we can help an everyday cook, we try to find those interactions where, you know, we can help people get from, you know, one level to the next. For someone like yourself, it could be, you may not need guided cooking, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're maybe more sophisticated and you like to have control. But right. because you like to have control, maybe you would like to have a sous chef in that in your home, right? So an extra set of hands that can help you. And so are there ways that we can actually help you multitask and do more things effectively because you're doing more complex tasks than maybe the everyday cook might be doing? And so those are the opportunity areas that we look at.
Right. Yes. You know, really just some of the pain points in cooking, you know, really just come down to knowing what to do. And like, if you are maybe a first time cooker, like you're cooking a recipe for the first time, you know, you're not going to realize that, you know, you kind of get halfway through a recipe and they're like, make sure that the meat is room temperature. And you're like, ugh, you know, and now you have to wait for it to, you know, kind of warm up to room temperature. And I'm assuming that, you know, having maybe a smart appliance sitting there, you know, kind of reading out the instructions and, you know, kind of letting you know that ahead of time would be very helpful and, as you said, convenient, I guess.
Yeah, that's right. And, you know, the we have a product called the Kitchen Hub, mm-hmm. which does provide that kind of experience. You could see it there in that profile screen. Oh, yeah. It's over the range there.
Right.
And so there is an application that does just that, where we can give people kind of that upfront knowledge before they even start engaging in the cooking experience of all the things they might need to do, and even do things like conversions. So to your point, not only halfway through do you need to realize that the meat should be room temperature, but let's say the recipe calls for 4 servings and you need 8, you know, right. What is the real conversion? It's not 2 times, right? A lot of times it's not a straight linear conversion. So, you know, I think you nailed it on the head, like trying to find those simple ways to make cooking more enjoyable while taking out a lot of the, you know, I call it cognitive load that goes to waste on just simple things that you might have missed.
Mm-hmm. In terms of appliances, like there's always room to improve appliances. You know, let's say someone has maybe a 5 or 6 year old, you know, fridge or stove or whatever. They're going to, you know, those appliances are still going to be perfectly good, and you know that's great. But I guess appliances made today are going to be a little bit more efficient. That's great. But from the technology side, I wanted you to speak to just, you know, the intelligence and the connectivity and the ease of use. Have there been a lot of improvements in the last couple of years, especially when it comes to kind of the connected kitchen?
There's been a lot of improvements, and some of it's been external, mm-hmm. and some of it's been internal. And so I think externally, you know, the advances with voice assistants, you know, with Amazon Alexa, Google yeah. Assistant, you know, has really, I think, helped drive the IoT industry and accelerated a lot of its adoption, because I think that really brought to life, you know, the why. Why would I want particular IoT devices? Why would this make my life better? Because being able to use your voice in your own words, you know, is such a great user interface, right? And so I think that has been a really great accelerator to drive adoption and a great advancement for the industry overall.
Right.
You know, from a product perspective, you know, I think the one thing that is always kind of helpful, especially in any kind of, you know, product like this is any advances that can kind of make the interaction better on the appliance or to make connectivity easier. And, you know, I think a lot of the things that we can do now with our smartphones in terms of just how do we get people connected and things like that have continuously improved and will only get better over time.
For sure.
And then obviously things like cloud infrastructure. You know, I know the cloud is not new, mm-hmm. But, you know, at the same time, you know, the tools that our partners continue to develop for these cloud platforms get better and better and better. You know, open source tools for machine learning, all sorts of other types of things that help us scale and be more efficient. In the end, helps us build more and more features more quickly and do more interesting things more quickly. And so I think that's kind of been, you know, really impactful for the industry. And you'll start to see some of this stuff manifest itself in our product. You know, for example, we did a demonstration at the at CES and the Kitchen and Bath Show.
I was there.
Oh, awesome. Cool.
Yeah.
Well, you know, we did a demonstration where we were using computer vision to help with the cooking process, right? Mm-hmm. And we were running local models on the Kitchen Hub there. So it was all running locally. I was using the camera and doing object detection. And, you know, we showcased how that experience could come together. 5 years ago, you know, you probably would have needed a team of engineers to pull something like that off. And today, you can do that stuff relatively quickly. It's commoditized, right? It's amazing. And so I think those are the types of innovations you'll start to see roll out much, much more as, you know, the years go by.
Yeah. And I was just going through my phone to see if I had any of the pictures from your actual display. I'm here with the cars and, you know, not here with all the appliances, but yeah, it was really incredible to see it kind of all happen, especially in a setting like that. And I guess it would be even better to have that convenience happening, you know, kind of in your home. And we're going to talk about the Kitchen Hub here in just a moment. But I wanted to kind of get, obviously over the past, past 10 months, let's not sugarcoat it. There's been a pandemic and a lot of people have, eating out was not an option for many, many weeks, there. And, you know, restaurants started to change the way that they deliver food and they prepared food. So a lot of people spent a lot of time at home, and I'm sure that GE has noticed this as well. One of the biggest trends when this whole pandemic first started were that people were spending more time at home, so they wanted to make their home nicer to live in. Renovations were huge, and I'm sure that kitchen renovations happened all the time. And some of these new appliances, I'm sure, have... And here's the part I'm going to ask you. Do you think that one of the trends was, because of COVID and cooking from home and things like that, some of the improvements in the adoption of smart appliances? And first of all, do you think obviously you would think that that's a good thing, but do you think that there was any kind of trend that, you know, hey, people are upgrading their kitchens, let's upgrade to this? Or, yeah, how has COVID affected this line of products?
We've definitely seen a huge uptick in adoption in terms of, you know, people, you know, connecting their appliances and interacting with their appliances through the smart capabilities. And, you know, we watch that stuff in the trends very closely. And I do think, you know, because we're at home and we're starting to, you know, basically your house is turned into your home, your office, and your school. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it is now an all-in-one kind of world. And so I think in many ways, back to the multitasking, kind of thing, is that, you know, smart appliances help you do more, you know, while you have to do other things. And so I think people saw the benefit of, hey, I can turn on my oven remotely. So if you're doing the kids' homework and you're upstairs, you can preheat the oven. You don't have to step away and go downstairs to do it. You know, getting notifications when things are done, you know, helps you optimize, you know, your time and what you're doing, and allows you to focus on the task at hand versus checking on things. And so I think these micro interactions actually end up having huge payback when people think about it. You know, I know you were talking to Whitney earlier, but the team had done some research with some consultants earlier in terms of how we manage our time. And how do we segment our time throughout the day? And how many decisions does the human need to make? And, you know, part of that, what we found out was, one, you know, that obviously this was before COVID, you know, we were just bombarded with decisions we needed to make, like nonstop, constantly, especially with the rise of digital. And smart appliances it takes away some of the pain of needing to make quick decisions and having to manage multiple tasks simultaneously, which was a positive thing. The other thing too is that, you know, research has been shown that the average American family spends anywhere from, you know, 45 minutes to 2.5 hours a week deciding what they want for dinner.
Seems low.
Right. So, you know, I think that, again, with things like the Kitchen Hub, you know, and other people too out there, we have partners like Drop and Innit and recipe partners like that, Heston, who kind of, they take that friction away, right? And so if you're trying to help your kids with their homework, if you're trying to manage your job, you know, while you're working from home, and you're also trying to put dinner on the table, these things in concert make that easier. Don't make it perfect, but they make it right. a lot easier.
Yeah, they're and really, you know, some of the solutions that we've been seeing, there's almost this ecosystem that, you know, we've seen from other manufacturers. I'm sure GE has as well, where, you know, it's not just like each appliance is convenient to use by itself. But, you know, I've seen systems like you scan things before you put them in the fridge, and then the fridge knows what's in there. It'll tell you before it expires. And then, like you mentioned, when you're looking up recipes, it'll be like, oh, you have all the ingredients for this. Here's the recipe, you can go ahead and do that. Does GE have the same philosophy? And after this, I think we're going to segue into the Kitchen Hub 2.0. But as far as all appliances working together, and I guess people investing in you know, making sure that they you know, kind of really get themselves involved with all the different appliances and how they interact. Does GE have that? That idea that everything's going to be connected?
Absolutely. And it's critical. We need to have that point of view, because that's what the consumer expects. You know, most consumers, when they buy an IoT device, have indicated that it needs to be interoperable. So we have taken the position that, you know, we're going to be an open platform. And so we have an appliance API that allows us to integrate with other systems and allows our partners to integrate with us. And, you know, it's a relatively public API. You know, we allow people access to it. And with very little interaction from us, you can actually do some pretty cool stuff with our appliances, you know, through this API. And we consider it, you know, a key piece of our smart home strategy is that interoperability, is the ecosystem. You know, we just launched a partnership with Sonos. Mm-hmm. So that your appliances can communicate with your Sonos speakers throughout your house and send you notifications. And the thing to keep in mind, right, is, you know, that may seem novel, right? Okay, I can get a notification through my speaker. That's interesting. But, you know, that's just the beginning, right? If you think about the future and, you know, all the potential possibilities that might enable, you know, there's some pretty cool things that you might be able to do now that these things can start to talk to each other.
Yeah, you know, if you have whole home music playing in your home, and, you know, suddenly the timer goes off for your oven, but you have music playing because you can't hear it, heck, it would be super nice if your oven were to override your music just for a second to let you know, hey, the oven's done, because I think we've all been there. We've all forgotten something in our oven, and yeah, so something really as simple as that. And, you know, we've been talking about, again, oven, microwave, fridge, stovetop, you know, all these different appliances. And I think that the Kitchen Hub, though, it you know, I could say that it kind of replaces the vent hood, but at the same time, I really feel like this is almost like in a whole new appliance for the kitchen. This is not something that you kind of augmented. This is, I guess you're trying to put this as a new brain to a smart kitchen, and that's I think what makes it stand out, because you're not really trying to persuade people to get rid of their old fridge. Like, this is something completely new. Talk about the impetus behind this. Talk about how this fits into people's home, and I guess last, talk about how it works.
Yeah, I think it's a great way to put it, Ben. And when we looked at, you know, what we wanted to do in terms of developing a new solution for our owners, again, we kind of looked back from what is our owner trying to achieve. And again, it went back to, you know, cooking and the kitchen being kind of the social heart of the home, right? It's where a lot of us are now gathering all the time. You know, open kitchen concepts are now, you know, relatively common. And so when we looked at that, you know, we realized that we had to develop a product that not only could interface well with our cooking products and give people more capability from that perspective, but also had to be experiential and usable in the right context. And if you think about where the Kitchen Hub gets installed over the range, you know, it's at that right, you know, level, right? It's there at eye level. It's accessible. You can reach it. You know, we've tested,
just out of range of the kids. Yeah.
Just out of range of the kids. And you know, we also back to the open posture, right? It runs Android out of the box. And so basically you can download any app you want from the Google Play Store and customize that product to meet your family's needs. And so, you know, really just trying to focus again on, you know, what is it that the family's trying to do? And what is the product concept that we can develop that'll help them achieve that? And that's kind of what drove the vision for the Kitchen Hub.
What was, you know, again, kind of bringing all these experiences to something that really for everyone out there who can't see the actual product that we're looking at, again, it's about the size of a vent hood. I don't know if you have the direct dimensions, Jeremy, for the screen size, but it is essentially a very large touchscreen.
Yeah, it's a 27-inch display, and right there on that picture, Ben, you know, what I'd like to call out, and that's the recipe app, right? Flavorly.
Yeah.
The other cool thing about this product, especially given these times, you know, where we may not be able to travel to family and friends, you know, there's two cameras on this product. There's one forward-facing, and there's one that faces down towards the cooktop. And so what's really neat about this product is that you can actually share, you know, your cooking experience with friends and family while you're hanging out in the kitchen. You know, we call it social cooking. You know, if mom can't come over, but you still want her help, you know, she could see what you're doing on the cooktop and give you advice on, you know, what you're preparing. The other thing too, that's cool, is if you're, you know, a social media celebrity or you're an aspiring social media celebrity, you can stream what you're cooking from your cooktop to your Instagram feed or Facebook feed or your favorite social channel.
Right.
And of course, and there's my dog.
Also wants to be famous. And I'm, and actually gotta say that for, I'm sure that design wise, that was not at hard, not hard at all to do, to just add an additional camera, you know, to the front. You were going to do that anyway. So add a second camera pointing down, seems like something that, you know, maybe would not be obvious because, you know, it's very much, you know, hey, the people are in the kitchen and the people are not on the stove, hopefully, you know, hey, so that's where the camera should point. But by adding a second camera down, I can definitely see how, you know, that opened so many more possibilities for your team.
Yeah. And like I said, we demonstrated the computer vision technology. And I think the other thing you kind of called out there, right, is, you know, this is part of, you know, the new technologies out there that allows us to move faster, right? A mobile device and hardware like this tablet, you know, they support two cameras, right? You have a forward-facing camera and a camera on the back of your smartphone, and so do most tablets. And so it's, you know, being kind of creative in our thinking in terms of how do we apply technology that exists so we can move faster and do cooler things,
right?
You know, without reinventing the wheel, right?
It's and really, you know, a touchscreen of this size, I've seen them in not of this size. This would really never fit on a fridge of you know, of kind of that size. But yeah, so something like a fridge, I think, is also trying to you know, kind of have these features. But really, just having that display and that touchscreen, and we have this actually in my home where you know, if someone knocks on the front door and I'm in the kitchen making dinner, I can actually bring up the display of the front door, you know, kind of on the kitchen, you know, kind of interact and see that kind of thing. You know, we talked a lot about connecting kitchen appliances to this, but this works. What ecosystems does this work? Because I see Google Assistant, obviously, you know, and I'm assuming that anything that works with Android or has an Android app, this is going to work with that.
Yeah, that's correct. So if you wanted to download your Ring doorbell app or any of your favorite IoT apps
or Netflix
that you use, you can watch Netflix, you can listen to Spotify. Google Assistant is built in. So that's because we run Android natively. So the possibilities are really limitless when you think about what you can do with this product.
So, and I like this one because we were talking about, you know, kind of following recipes and, you know, learning how to cook things and things like that. But you also look like you pair with Flavorly and, you know, and SciChef, of course, that, hey, you get to record yourself cooking. It's not even just like, here's a recipe and here's my life story and then, you know, mix the two together. No, you actually get to record a video that others can follow along, which I think, honestly, in these times, I've heard so many, you know, we used to do, I think people have hopefully gotten the message, a lot about data backup. And people always talk about, you know, there's a house fire, all of my grandmother's recipes are gone, you know, it's awful, I should have backed them up, or I did back them up, but it's only on the one hard drive that burned down. This excites me because you can have grandma doing her thing, and you can actually record her explaining, cooking, and doing that whole thing. Is that something that anyone has ever approached you and said, you know, I'm having family recipes. Like, even if I'm not going to share them and try to be the next Emeril Lagasse, I can at least record them for my own viewing, I guess.
Yeah, one of our very first customers was somebody who bought the product because of its ability to take pictures of her recipe cards and store them on the Kitchen Hub. And to your point, you know, you can record these sessions as well now, and share those. So that absolutely was top of mind when we started thinking about what people might do with this product. And, you know, people, whenever we demonstrated those capabilities, you would see the delight in their faces that they might be able to do that. And, you know, as we talked about it earlier, right, cooking is an emotional experience, mm-hmm. right? Everybody probably has at least one, you know, positive memory of, you know, cooking with their family, what it means to them.
Yeah, it's definitely a much better way to experience this with, you know, hey, we're not allowed to travel. I'm sure that a lot of people felt lonely cooking in their kitchen this holiday season. So this would be a great way to, you know, to kind of do that because, hey, works with Skype and all that good stuff. I got to say, though, that one thing that you mentioned when you mentioned API, so many of our security stories or cybersecurity stories are that, you know, kind of an API let too much information out, you know, user or, you know, evil people were able to request more information than they could have through an API. I'm not saying that APIs are inherently bad. I'm saying that sometimes APIs are kind of overlooked. You know, they want to make sure that things are interoperable, but they don't want to, I guess, kind of lock it down too much, and they accidentally end up spreading too much information. Security-wise, I mean, you know, kind of just as I understand it, I mean, this thing's going to be in people's kitchens. That's where people have their private conversations. This is the center of their home. You know, they don't want themselves spied on. They don't want themselves overheard. What has GE Appliances done to make sure that, you know, this is secure? And, you know, is it secure?
Yeah, it's a great question, Ben. I'm glad you brought it up. You know, our philosophy, obviously, is to design with, you know, security in mind. Right. So we take it very, very seriously. And it's very important to us. Our owners are very important to us. Their safety and their peace of mind are some of the most important things to us when we think about designing our products. And on the screen, you're showing mm-hmm. our UL cybersecurity verification. And so for those not familiar with UL, they're a third party governing body that does a lot of things like they certify products and make sure they're safe, you know, for homes, right?
Make sure they don't explode your house. Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but now they also provide a verification based on, you know, criteria that they've developed to certify people at different levels. And, you know, we achieved the gold rating, and not only did we achieve this gold rating with UL, but we were the first manufacturer to actually get this certification from UL. And so we had it pass, you know, through their rigorous process and go through their evaluation. And yeah, I think, you know, the big reasons why we were able to get this verification is first, you know, we adhere to the same security practices that you would find in the financial sector, mm-hmm. right? So we try to, you know, step it up and make sure that we are following some of the best practices there are out there. Just in the overall industry, not just the appliance industry. The second is, you know, we're adhering to the CCPA guidelines, which for those not familiar are the new privacy guidelines that California has instituted,
right,
that protect the consumer's privacy and provides all sorts of new tools for consumers to be able to manage their privacy the way they should. And so we immediately stepped up to make sure we could adhere to those standards because we know it's important. And so I would say for us, privacy is a feature. You know, security is a feature. It's not something we need to do. It's something that we want to do because we know that it benefits our owners.
Right. No, it's very, very well said. And that whole thing about privacy, I mean, that's something that even my own brother still has trouble dealing with, that, you know, having digital assistants and cameras in the home. It took me a little bit, but after reading about the technology and how it works and, you know, getting assurances like the one that you just gave for GE appliances, I mean, security... Maybe back in the early, 2010s, when every webcam came with default admin username, admin password, and, everything was just kind of open, that might have been the case. But I've noticed lately, especially from companies like GE, that security is not an afterthought anymore.
Yeah, that's right. If you think about our partners as well, everybody has a stake in making sure everybody is working securely and in the best way possible. You know, I think the good news to your point is there's not just better awareness of, basic security measures. You know, I think there's actually real leadership now in just thinking in terms of how we can develop more secure products just overall. Right. And we do. We have people who specialize in this that work for us. Who are constantly looking at this. And, for example, we go to Black Hat every year. Well, I guess we won't go this year, but we actually take our products to see if people can exploit them so we can learn and make sure that we are, staying up to snuff, and we have an open channel to anybody that does find vulnerabilities or wants to find vulnerabilities.
Bug bounty program. And
gotcha. We also embrace the community, right? We're engaged.
No, that's super important because obviously you can, companies can try to payroll as many cybersecurity experts as they want, but it's never going to be as powerful as a crowdsourced, thousands of eyeballs looking at something. It's good to be connected with the community. And so those partnerships aside, though, I wanted to get back to kind of the features. So we know it's secure. This opens up other possibilities, not just between appliances, not just between people and their families, but let's face it, other companies. And I think that Americans in particular are really relying on, kind of a smaller handful of companies to provide more and more for them. Amazon is obviously a big one with home delivery, grocery delivery. You have grocery delivery apps out there that, will essentially go shopping right down the street for you and deliver to your door. Lots of food delivery and things like that. Have you seen any kind of interest, or have you kind of maybe pursued anything that, I know that you have like the recipe recording and the recipe kind of display, but I mean, as far as all the other apps that we're using to, I guess, manage our food situation, do you see any kind of interplay there between these apps and the Smart Hub or even just the GE ecosystem?
I think we'll see more interplay starting to manifest itself now that, COVID has really, accelerated people's adoption of things like food delivery, grocery delivery, and things like that. Prior to COVID, it still felt like it was early days for a lot of this stuff. Adoption was still, it was growing, health in a strong rate, but, it was still just kind of growing. But now it's like, it is now here, right? Mm-hmm. It is here to stay. It is now part of our lives. It is something that is now established, just like e-commerce was, everybody's like, well, maybe one day I'll shop online. Then all of a sudden here we are shopping everything online. So as we start to see this industry kind of retake shape, because that in some ways that's what it's doing, it's reforming a bit because of this acceleration. We want to start to look at what are the strategic areas we can focus on. And then keep in mind, it all goes back to the owner. Where is it that we can make the owner's life better with the products we make? And what are those services that they use that we can potentially integrate with or interoperate with to provide that value?
No, it makes, and of course makes perfect sense. So anyone out there watching the video portion, you can also see that there are tons of different smart appliances that we didn't even get to. You know, everything from ice makers, wall ranges, smart microwaves, which by the way, smart microwave, I recently brought one into the house, and I'm using it, and I find it silly at the same time, but I also find it very convenient. I mean, it's just that adjustment period. I don't know if you've ever brought these into your home, Jeremy, and you were like, well, you know, I could just press the one button, or I could have, you know, or I could just say the words. It's fun to use. It really is.
Yeah. And, you know, to me, it was kind of a dark horse. The other thing to think about too is that the microwave has a relatively compact and complex control because of all the things it needs to do. Mm-hmm. And because of that, you know, not a lot of people necessarily know how to use all the functions of a microwave. Being able to use your voice, just tell it what you want to do, makes it easier. And then if you think about people with limited abilities, you know, it actually provides a lot of, yeah. And, you know, we get comments all the time about, you know, people being so excited that they can use their voice. One shout out, though, I want to give to an appliance or product we make that doesn't get a lot of attention.
Sure.
Is the whole home water filter. It's the one on the bottom right there. It's a product that we make. And first of all, it is a filtration system for your whole home, right? So that alone provides tremendous benefit for every household.
I actually grew up with the GE water filter, but that thing was installed in like the 90s. So, yeah.
Okay. You might want to change the filter on that thing.
Funny story. We were fixing the house up to sell it. And like we remembered that it was there. And we did not change the filter for 18 years. If it were connected to the internet, we would have gotten an alert, but it was an 18-year-old filter. We did not die. We're okay. But we did have one.
Well, that's
and
good.
Only one.
Not only will this tell you that when you need a filter, which is important, but it also is checking flow rate. And what that can do for you actually is give you an alert if you have a potential leak. And the leak may not be coming from a pipe or something to that effect. It could be a toilet that's running, whatever the case might be. It has sensors to detect that flow rate and can send you notifications. And if you're not home, you can do a remote shutoff. So it can actually shut off the water inlet to your house.
Wow.
So just in case you have potential water damage occurring, you can kind of head it off at the pass and make sure you're preventing catastrophic damage. And so I love all of our smart appliances. Right. Love them to death. This one is my favorite by far because...
Yeah. That one, I've heard stories that, you know, even like water, you know, kind of water mains break in people's front yard. And I know that this is installed before it goes into the home, so it wouldn't necessarily track that. But, you know, kind of bursting in, let's say, basements and cellars and places like that. And then, you know, the water company, after maybe like $30,000 worth of water, they'll come out and be like, you know, you guys are using a lot of water. Let's shut this off and see what's happening. That is a new one, especially the whole home shutoff. That is something that, you know, going through a renovation currently, I've had to shut off the water a number of times. If I could do that with my phone, that'd be...
Yeah.
Where were you like 10 months ago? That would have been so helpful, so helpful.
No kidding.
So speaking of which, you know, little improvements like that, you know, putting a flow sensor, that's been on the market for a number of years. But, you know, just that little improvement and integration makes it such a useful product. I'm afraid to ask this because, you know, this might take another hour. But what's next for GE appliances?
Well, obviously, you know, continue to drive more innovation on the platform as a whole. You know, we have a great brand and profile, which you see on the screen there. Mm-hmm. You know, that is what's really leading the way in terms of our smart appliances and their capabilities. And so what I think you'll start to see is more automation, more AI capabilities, more of what Google calls kind of like the ambient home, where we can hopefully start to understand what you want to do and be able to start to take on those tasks, but without you having to take the proactive step, right? Really totally taking that friction out. The other side is, you know, you kind of mentioned the B2B side of things. You know, we have customers too that are, you know, either retailers or they're home builders or property managers who install our products. I mean, a lot of us buy homes with our appliances in them, but we have customers who buy our products and install them to sell to consumers, and providing them with tools and applications that help them actually get more value out of the products that they're managing. For property managers, they care about leaks too, mm-hmm. right? They care about tenant satisfaction. They care about providing greater levels of service and convenience. And so we're developing all sorts of new tools and software platforms to enable those sorts of experiences. And then, the other thing I would mention is, not everything about our smart home strategy is about the actual features that we develop, right? It's actually having a total, I would say thought leadership perspective in the smart home space and trying to provide our customers and our owners with either more content or provide them with even just, better experiences. I'll plug our podcast. We have a podcast called Adaptivate, and its main mission is just to provide our customers with insights into, making their jobs and lives easier by talking to other professionals like yourself to, start to synthesize some of those learnings. And so, us as a smart appliance company, it's more than just building great product that can do great things. We want to be great at every aspect of our customer and owner's lives. And that means being, there for them in all sorts of different ways. There it is. You can subscribe.
Yeah. We'll throw it up in the show notes. And I think that, of course, speaking of the show notes, Jeremy, I should have called it before. You explained all that perfectly, and that these are some of my favorite technology innovations, is because, like, I know that some people want to come into the technology space and they want to hear about, like, this is going to completely upend the industry, it's going to revolutionize everything. But I think that some of the most impressive changes to technology are small, iterative, and, just kind of work, like, they already work and they just work in a new way. That is really what makes immediate and quick change. And it seems like you're rolling a lot of that into a lot of your appliances.
Yeah, sorry, you broke up there at the end, I do agree.
Yeah.
Incremental improvements can lead to big changes, right? Yeah. We're on a journey, and I think we have developed a platform that helps us scale and will allow us to get there. And so I totally agree, right? Taking that iterative approach is great.
For sure. And of course, everyone out there, we're going to go ahead and call the interview there. But if you want to find out more, there's geappliances.com, and this is /pro. So this is going to have everything from, all the different lines that you have: Monogram, Cafe, you mentioned, Profile, GE, obviously, Air, Hot Point. And of course, a lot of these, I mean, and also just real quick, Jeremy, do you see that this is something that is going to be reserved for top of the line, best of the best, or do you see more smart features coming to all parts of GE's lineups?
Well, I'm glad you asked that question. Actually, we have smart product across a wide range of our models and all of our brands. At the end of this year, we'll have over 600 models with embedded Wi-Fi on them.
Wow.
We just have a wide range of connected product. And as you saw that screen earlier with the whole home water filter, mm-hmm. we're also connecting just about everything we make. We believe in, making the whole home smart. We're not just focusing on cooking or just focusing on a couple of products. Like, we're making everything connected and smart.
Right.
So it's just part of our overall strategy and is now just ingrained in how we think about product.
That's perfect. And because honestly, I don't see the internet going away. I think it's caught on. We're going to keep it one way or another, but everyone,
I don't know if I'm there yet.
You're on it. You're in the cloud. So everyone, we've been talking to Mr. Jeremy Miller. He is the, once again, he is the Smart Home Solutions Commercial Director for GE Appliances. And everyone, actually, Jeremy, I'll let you have the last word. If people want to find out more information, where can they go?
I'll just go to geappliances.com and click our Smart Appliances tab, and you can check out our full lineup there. If you go to geappliances.com/pro, right. If you're on the B2B side, you can get all the information you need on that site as well.
But okay, so we'll keep GE appliances there. You know, they're on the website, but I think a lot of people are. You know, a lot of guests that come on the show are from, you know, kind of lesser known companies and things like that. But I think that a lot of people know about GE. But hey, a link doesn't hurt. And Jeremy, I want to thank you so much for coming on the program and talking with us. This was I know that when I mentioned this to my girlfriend, I was like, I'm going to be talking to GE Appliances. And she's like, oh, exciting. And I'm like, it really is, isn't it? But trust me, there's a lot of fun, innovative stuff happening with, especially with, you know, cars, kitchen. I mean, it's not all just cell phones. You have a lot on your plate, and I think you're having fun with it.
Thank you, Ben. And I really appreciate you having us. And this was tons of fun. And I look forward maybe to talking again in the future.
Absolutely. I mean, CES 2021 is just around the corner. I'm sure that there's some stuff to announce there. We'll definitely be in touch. Thank you so much.
All right. Thanks. Take care, Ben.
All right. Have a good one. And everyone out there, once again, ComputerAmerica.com will have the show notes. So Jeremy's going to go ahead and step out. And ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go ahead and do computer and technology news. That's brought to you by Computer America. So everyone, let's go ahead and get to that. And yeah, a lot of great stories. We got this. Here we go. All right, everyone. So there you go. That's and we're going to keep all of those links kind of together that of everything that we showed during the GE conversation. And then we're going to have these news stories. And turns out that a lot of stories are concerned with the hack that we covered yesterday with SolarWinds. And so if you want to go back to the show, listen to that. But a quick recap, a company that actually provides like email support and services to 425 of the top 500 blue chip companies in the United States, as well as the Department of Defense and like many other departments of I think it was like the Department of not Finance, but the Treasury, the Treasury Department, was hacked by a, you know, what they assumed to be a Russian hacker, because it's all the telltale signs. And then, of course, on top of that, the intrusion happened for months at a time. So any communication that was happening in that time was, of course, compromised. So that's a very big story. And unfortunately, that's about all we know, because it's going to take a long time if we ever find out the true extent of what happened at that. So instead, we're going to cover some of the other stories here as well. And I think that our first story, let's see. I think that our first story, we could do the one about the robots. Let's go ahead and talk about how the UK is being a party pooper and UK politicians. Here we go. Again, check out the video portion for this. But UK politicians call for making the resale of goods purchased using an automated bot an illegal activity, which now obviously, you know, kind of paying attention, with the sale of an automated bot. I guess that is the important part. For those of you who don't know, this is why when you go to purchase back in the day before COVID, when you went to go purchase, you know, kind of tickets to your favorite musician that's coming to town or your football game or whatever, whenever you went to go buy tickets online, all of them were sold out like within seconds, not even minutes, but seconds. Because minutes, you could kind of think, oh, wow, a lot of people really want this and I got to be quick. But when it's seconds, yeah, these bots have already mapped out how the checkout process works, any information that they need to put in, and bots just quickly just boom, 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 just check out with everything there. This is what happened with PlayStation, Xbox. This is what happened with graphics cards and CPUs. Anytime a new product hits the market, bots do this. Scalpers get all of the product. And then that's why you see eBay listings for, let's say, a graphics card that would normally run you about $600 is being scalped online for about $1,500 the very next day. Sure, a couple of them could be by individuals, but the majority of them are by bots. And bots are just strictly not fair, you know, they're cheating. So let's talk about this. Six Scottish National Party politicians have put forward a motion for consideration in the UK Parliament to ban or prohibit the resale of game consoles and PC components at prices greatly above MSRP, and the resale of goods purchased using automated bots to be made illegal in these fair aisles. There you go. So at least in Ireland, or I should say the UK. They mentioned a motion on the, quote, resale of gaming consoles and computer components purchased by automated bots has been tabled with UK Parliament, and it aims to outlaw resellers using automated bots. So, obviously, the motion has no set date, blah, blah, blah. They're going to work on it in the near future, and they're trying to track down a, you know, people, they're trying to help people who are trying to get, let's say, a PlayStation 5 or, you know, the NVIDIA 3080. They're trying to help those people who just are legitimate customers but can't purchase one, and yet there's a flood of them for resale on eBay. And it's one of those situations where this is legislation that is strictly aimed to help the consumer, which I'm actually totally for, because anywhere that you fall on this entire spectrum of this argument, let's say you say that, oh, bots aren't really an issue, it's just there's such high demand and that the companies aren't making enough product, then hey, it shouldn't affect that whatsoever, and then we can have it out with the companies. Because if you think that bots aren't a problem, then banning bots shouldn't be a problem either. If you're on the other side where you think, man, bots are really ruining this and price gouging is really awful, then hey, that's going to stop that. The only people that this really affects are those who are trying to obtain these goods for that markup, for that sale, for those who are trying to profit off of them. Again, it's kind of funny that this is really concerned with the consumers, because as far as NVIDIA, AMD, Intel, you know, any of these other PC and, you know, Sony, Microsoft who make these things, they're getting their MSRP regardless. You know, they are the ones selling out of cards. They're getting their full value. The companies themselves really don't profit off this, but even they have started to throw up barriers to bots purchasing their goods. So they know it's a problem, but making it illegal, even though it might not stop it, because obviously enforcing this would be pretty hard to do, but at least having it illegal gives lawmakers and law enforcement a way to kind of enforce this, at least within their own country. And I am very appreciative that they at least are taking the effort to, it may be a small group of people who are taking offense to this, but at the same time, hey, I'm all for it. So there you go. Let's go ahead and, so there's our first story. Our second story, which I'm thinking we only have time for like one more quick one. One more quick one, and this is a pretty good one. If anyone wanted some hope for automated, wait, what was that last one? No, okay. For anyone out there hoping that, you know, hey, automated cars, when are they coming? Well, check out this story here by Lyft. Lyft aims, and recall, about 2 days ago, we covered a story that Uber had sold their automated driving company, or, you know, at least the part of their company that handled automated driving and, you know, kind of driver self-driving cars. They sold that. They got out of that business. They're no longer in that business. Whereas Lyft, their main competitor, is aiming to bring fully driverless cars to multiple U.S. cities in 2023. Check that out. Lyft has completed more than 100,000 self-driving rides in Las Vegas over the last few years. Now, the company has revealed plans to bring fully driverless cars to multiple cities in the United States starting in 2023. So, Motional, which is a joint venture between Aptiv and Hyundai, is Lyft's partner on that project, and it's recently received permission to test autonomous vehicles on Nevada's roads without safety drivers and cars, and it plans to do so in the coming months. The two companies will continue to work together on bringing those vehicles to multiple cities, and this is the first deployment partnership between a rideshare company and a driverless technology provider for a transportation service. It will handle the rideshare side of things, including rider experience, while Motional will manage the cars. So if you're wondering, you know, kind of how are they going to be able to make sure everything runs smoothly, that's how they're going to do it. Lyft is strictly the, you know, kind of getting you on, paying for it, making sure that everything goes well. And then the physical car aspect of it is handled by the automatic car or the automated car company. So with that being said, it's unclear in which cities the companies plan to fully deploy autonomous vehicles, but at first, of course, but they need approval from regulators in each jurisdiction before they do so. It's going to, like, self-driving cars, and they've been testing this for years, they need to seamlessly integrate with human drivers. As crappy as human drivers are, they need to make sure that they work seamlessly, because they're going to be interacting, and they need to be just on top of their game. So whatever happens here, I hope that happens soon, and I hope that happens in a neighborhood near me, because I really can't wait for self-driving cars. It's going to be incredible. Everyone, thank you so much for tuning into Computer America. I want to say, hey, have a great day. Thank you so much. And again, thank you to GE Appliances for coming on the program. It was a lot of fun. We'll catch you here next time. Everyone, have a great one. Bye.